Today, I'm very happy to introduce Dr. Alexander Poddubny, who is a researcher at both Yoffe Institute and at Moi University.
In Australia.
In Australia as well, I'm sorry. And he will be talking about magnetotoroidal non-reciprocity of second harmonic generation. Sasha, please.
Thank you very much. For the introduction, and it's first time I'm at this seminar, and also first time I'm talking about this material and the system, so it's new, at least for me, not so maybe new in general. So I will talk about an interplay of several effects. So one of them is nonlinearity, so it will be second harmonic generation, as is shown here. So also, okay, so I'm trying to use it. Also something will be toroidal and something will be magnetic. And the work is mostly experimental, so it has been done in Dortmund University, and I'm a theorist, so there is no theory, real theory, but I've done some symmetry analysis, and basically also part of the goal of this talk is to advertise the material system, because it's maybe not so well known, but very special. So it's not a meta material, it's just a bulk crystal, and the crystal is called meta borate. So it is a dielectric. It has been known at least since early 19th century in some very early work by Mendeleev. He already cites that this crystal is known and its crystal structure has been solved. And maybe 20 years ago, they found it in nature. So there is a mineral called Santa Rosaite, and it can be found in Chile, and it has this peculiar blue color. So what is here for me? Why is this material special? Well, first, it has very complicated crystal structure. I have a semiconductor physics background, so I'm used to silicon, maybe gallium arsenide, where there are one or two atoms per unit cell. And here I show just one unit cell. So this picture shows one unit cell. There are many, many atoms. So I'm interested only in the green ones, which are copper ions. So the green ones, these are copper. And also there are two kinds of these copper ions. So two different crystallographic positions. So I am interested only in half of these copper ions. So only in this 4B. And don't ask me what is 4B. So I see a question from Lёша Slobozhanyuk. Is it possible to have a full screen? I'm not sure, because I want to use OneNote. I'm afraid everything will break. So if Anton tells me what can I do, I can, but I can increase zoom. So Lёша, especially for you, I can increase zoom on this crystal structure, and I will talk more about it. So one thing which is important is that the crystal structure is kind of complicated. There are many atoms in the unit cell. So that's it. And okay, so let me move a little bit further. So why is this material interesting? Well, because at least half of these copper ions have very narrow optical lines. So they have optical transitions, and there are some levels of these ions. I'm not a specialist in microscopic structure, but basically there are very, very narrow resonances at the energy about 1.4 electron volts. And these resonances can be propped in absorption and in emission and in second harmonic generation. So there are the super narrow resonances. This is first interesting thing. Another interesting thing is that these transitions, these resonances are coupled to spins. So each of these ions I show here two projections on the two axes. So there is the symmetry axis C is like Z, and there is some symmetry around the C axis. It's a tetragonal crystal structure. So each ion carries spin. So each ion so something is, I can probably do like this. Maybe this was the question. So each ion has optical transition and has spin. And then, well, what is the spin structure? It's very, very rich. The Knell temperature is 21K. And below the Knell temperature of 21 Kelvin, everything very strongly depends on the orientation of magnetic field and on temperature and on magnitude of magnetic field. So you can have ferromagnetic moment here, you can have antiferromagnetic moment. In the regime I'm talking about, there is antiferromagnetic moment, which is along this 45 degrees. So maybe it's like this. So this spin points here, this spin points there. So there is no net magnetic moment, but there is antiferromagnetic moment. And also this magnetic structure depends, so it's only its projection, like view from top. So you have these two things. You have magnetic order and you have resonances. And because of this, you have a lot of resonant magneto-induced effects and resonant magnetic effects. What people have seen, people, well, first they found this magnetic structure, then actually Roman Pisarev, who is like the main person in this study, they were the first who saw second harmonic generation at these transitions. And also what people are trying to do now is to just study linear optics and linear magneto-optics in this system. And it's a talk about non-reciprocity. So let me, so Maxim, question from Maxim Gorlich, what is antiferromagnetic moment? Thank you, it was not clear. So it's just L is S1 minus S2. So it's antiferromagnetic moment. So half of the spins point to the right, half of the spins point, say, to the left. So total on average magnetization is zero, but there is antiferromagnetic moment L. So there can be also ferromagnetic moment, which is a sum of these two. Maxim has a question. I'm not sure. So Maxim says that he has a question. I cannot unmute Maxim.
Okay. Hi, Sasha. Thanks. But does this antiferromagnetic moment depends on the choice of the unit cell? Because I can see that if you are shifting the unit cell, you can somehow play with this S1 and S2.
Not really. So I'm here showing the one unit cell. All unit cells are the same. I can put it like this. The period of the magnetic lattice is the same as the period of the antiferromagnetic lattice. So in that sense, it's okay. It's also possible to have an incommensurate phase in this system. And in incommensurate phase, in different crystallographic planes, the spins like rotate, and by some angles, say 10 degrees. And in that case, you don't have even average spin. But I am talking about the commensurate phase.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. So thanks.
There are two types of copper ions. On half of them, it points to plus 45 degrees, and to other half, it points to to the opposite direction.
Mm-hmm. Good, thanks.
So Recently, people started to analyze magneto-optics and non-reciprocal effects in this system. So what can happen? What is non-reciprocity? Well, Lorentz reciprocity is like third Newton's law in optics. So third Newton's law, if A pushes B, B pushes A with the same force. So reciprocity means that transmission from left to right is the same as transmission from right to left. But this is only true if your medium is linear and if it's not magnetic. Today I will talk about different ways to break non-reciprocity. So one is non-linearity, another is application of magnetic field. And the one of the classic effects is the Faraday rotation, another is the circular dichroism, which I show here. So if I think it's very, very interesting. Yeah, so if light propagates along magnetic field, it can propagate, but it if it propagates in the opposite direction, it is attenuated. So this is linear dichroism, circular dichroism in a magnetized medium. But actually there are much more effects because in addition to this kind of effects, so it's described what by some constants. If I write the permittivity tensor E alpha beta, it is what something like this, I think. So there are some anti-symmetric components in the permittivity tensor. But other effects are also possible. So for instance, you can have a spatial dispersion, and the spatial dispersion can be controlled by the magnetic field. And also what you can have is anisotropy. So this material I'm talking about, it's anisotropic. It has a preferential axis. So there are many more effects even in linear magneto-optics in addition to Faraday effect and circular dichroism. And couple of them which were recently studied experimentally for exactly the same system is for copper metaborate are this. So on the left I show refraction controlled by magnetic field. So it's like non-reciprocal refraction of light. And what they did, they measured very, very small shift, which is gained when the light passes through the crystal. And when it goes from left to right, it's the shift is positive. When it goes from right to left, the shift is also positive. And it means that it's kind of non-reciprocal. So it's because in usual configuration, if light goes from left to right and shifts up, then in reciprocal configuration, it would have shifted down, but it still shifts up. So there is this shift up built in the crystal, and they even speculate that it's related to toroidal moment. So I also will have some toroidal moment. And so it's maybe something very, very interesting and complementary. Another effect which happens, which has been recently reported in the same system, is one-way transparency. So what do they claim? They say that in one direction, light is transmitted as if nothing happens, as if it were a glass. So in this direction, it goes freely. And in the opposite direction, it is not transmitted at all. So, well, okay, it's experimental work. And of course, it's a question, what does mean is not transmitted at all? And basically what they say is that they have electric dipole transitions, but also they have magnetic dipole transitions. And these transitions can interfere. So you have like a one-way Huygens element or whatever. And this all happens because you have these resonances. It's about 1.4 electron volts. And each atom of copper has a non-centrosymmetric background. So there is both electric and magnetic dipole moment contribution. And also it is very, very sensitive to magnetic field. So basically the goal of this picture is to show that there are more interesting effects even in linear magneto-optics than just Faraday rotation and circular dichroism. Another effect is optical control of magnetism, which has been also reported for this material. So what is magnetoelectricity? It is a linear link between polarization and magnetic field. So usually polarization is proportional to electric field, right? But here you can have P or vector D has terms proportional to magnetic field in this material. And you can control these terms optically. So you send a pulse and then you control this magnetoelectricity. And I think that there will be a talk Anton just mentioned by Alexei Kimmel from Netherlands. And last week, or maybe a week ago. So B is, okay, so it's a good question from Vanya Yorsh. I will answer it. So there was a talk by Alexandra Kalashnikova somewhere, not on this seminar, but like a public lecture. And there will be a talk by Alexei Kimmel from Netherlands, and they're expert in optical control of magnetism. So here it's something related. So in their experiment, basically both P and B are proportional to have some time dependence. It's an answer to question of Vanya Yorsh, I think. So it's both at the optical frequency, but in principle, there are also static magnetoelectric effects. I will talk about it today. So there are many interesting effects in this material. And now let me discuss our experimental results.
Sasha, just a second. We also have a question from Maxim Gorlich.
Sorry.
Thank you very much. So did I understand correctly that basically this material is simultaneously magneto-optical, but also like bianisotropic, since electric polarization is affected by magnetic field?
Yeah, Maxim. So there are two answers. So first, I don't really know. It's not been well studied. But apparently it has everything. So it is anisotropic. It is, and it's indeed, it has magnetoelectric coupling, and it's also widely tunable.
And since I have a chance to speak, I have just the next question. So you showed us very complicated unit cell, but what is the typical ratio of the unit cell size to the wavelength?
Very small, for sure.
So it is still much smaller than the wavelength. What is?
Yeah, it's, well, basically lattice constant along the crystallographic, the symmetry axis is 5 angstroms, and in transverse direction it's 11 angstroms.
Okay, so around.
But 10. It's still, well, you can talk about it. It's like a natural resonant metamaterial, which with strong nonlinearity, strong spatial dispersion, magnetic and optical control. You can, but it's a natural, well, it is grown in the lab, but in principle it's a material.
Mm-hmm. But so all these phenomena come from resonances, but not associated with large period. Okay.
There are some effects are actually not from resonances, but mostly today I'm speaking about this resonant transition. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, okay, so let me go to some original part. So what we say, what maybe has not been measured before in this material, is the magnetic control of second harmonic generation. So second harmonic generation has been measured by Pisarev, by the Dortmund group, but what has not been really measured is the ability to control second harmonic by magnetic field and also by changing the geometry of experiment. So what is done is like this. So you send two photons, you measure second harmonic signal, so it's also shown here. And there are different terms, different contributions responsible for the second harmonic. So one of them is due to this antiferromagnetic structure, because some spins are points up and some point down. One of the term is just because of the magnetic field. And also there is crystallographic second harmonic. So what has been shown, and at least apparently for the first time for this material, is the ability to control second harmonic due to interference of different sources. So this is antiferromagnetic source, antiferromagnetic. This is magnetic, and C is for crystallographic. So what we can do, we can play with the sources and control second harmonic. In principle, nothing special, but the effect is very, very strong and kind of dramatic. So these are maybe one of the two experimental figures I'm showing. So what they do? They send a signal and they see lines. So they see photons at half energy of this transition, and they see emission at about 1.4 electron volts. Of course, it's all done at low temperatures, because at high temperatures magnetic structure is destroyed, but they see two resonances. There is some splitting between them, and also there is some splitting even in each of the resonances. And it's a crystallographic splitting. I won't go into the details. Basically, what they see is first very narrow resonances, and second is that the amplitude of these resonances is very different for positive and negative magnetic field. So the degree of magnetic control, we call it magnetic non-reciprocity, but just if you call it magnetic control, the sensitivity is striking. So if you fix the energy, say here, for plus 8 tesla, you see huge signal. For minus 8 tesla, you don't see almost any signal. If you switch off, if you decrease the magnitude of magnetic field, of course, the amount of control will decrease, but still. So I will talk only most of the remaining time. I will talk about this experiment and how it can be understood and how is it related to magnetoelectric coupling, and toroidal moment, and everything. So basically, this is main experimental figure. Just I am not experimentalist at all. What I understand was important for this figure is that it's a second harmonic generation measured under excitation by a femtosecond pulse. So they sent a short pulse, which is still enough spectrally broad to cover both two resonances. And since it's pulse, you see a lot of second harmonic, but it's also spectrally tuned to this particular transition. And this ensures some, well, large signal. Apparently, people who studied this transition before never had such high spectral resolution. Okay, so let me try to explain this, but maybe before I will just slightly comment on the geometry of experiment. So it's very, very simple optics in principle. So incident light is along the symmetry axis of the crystal. So C is the optical axis. Second harmonic is perpendicular. So it lies in the plane and it is in the magnetic field. So only thing I want to do is to explain the selection rules in the remaining time. So one obvious point, can there be crystallographic contribution for second harmonic? So we are used to effects like this. E to omega alpha is proportional to some second order susceptibility. Chi alpha beta gamma E beta omega E gamma omega. So such crystallographic contribution is also present in this material, but it's absent in this particular geometry because it still has a, the unit cell is like a parallelepiped. So this chi, it has components just like in helium arsenide. So there are these terms, only this kind of terms. And this kind of terms are zero, they don't work in this geometry because incident light is along the crystallographic axis. And if incident light is along crystallographic axis, you don't see second harmonic because of this term, because you have, say, EZ omega and you don't have EY omega. It's just zero. So you have only EZ omega. That's why crystallographic contribution is absent. But there are contributions for second harmonic, which are proportional to magnetic field and to antiferromagnetic moment. So, and I will talk about this contribution. So basically two types of contributions. So this type of contributions and this type of contributions. And there are many indices. I won't go into the details. So maybe before explaining this particular experiment, I will talk a little bit more about magneto-electric coupling in this system, because also magneto-electric coupling is interesting for metamaterials and so on. So magneto-electric coupling in this system is possible because of the spins. So I have this resonant transition. They are very, very sharp and they are on the copper ions, but also every copper ion has a spin and the spin is strongly coupled to this transition. So some of the spins point to the left, some of the spins point to the right. And it's a little bit, it's a weird structure. I've been looking at it for some time. So here there are actually four planes. So these atoms have Z equal to zero. So then there are four atoms which are in the middle of the unit cell, like vertically. Then some of them are here, and there is also one on top. And so it's kind of complicated picture, and this complicated distribution of spins enables magneto-electric coupling. So the only thing I did for this work was some symmetry analysis, so making such nice tables, which I'm not going to comment on. I will just talk about the results. So what is magneto-electric coupling again? Let us talk in a little bit more detail. So I have and let us consider even zero frequency. So suppose that I have zero frequency, then this material is magneto-electric. It means that even static magnetic field can induce some polarization. So how does it happen? I need to have polarization stationary, which is proportional to magnetic field. And it's not so easy. Why is it not so easy in normal material? Because there is this time inversion symmetry. So if you make the transformation of time to minus time, the polarization is the same because it's just the distribution of charges. So it's plus it's minus and it's P. So polarization stays the same, but magnetic field, it's due to some rotation. So it changes sign. So the, it's just impossible. So P goes to P, B changes to minus B. It means that such coupling is impossible in normal material. It's possible at the frequency, at non-zero frequency, but it's non, it's not possible in the stationary case. But can I enable this? So in order to enable such coupling, I need the right hand side of this equation to be linear, to be independent of time inversion. So this does not change under the time inversion, but the right hand side changes. So what I can do, I can put here something depending on the spins. And if I put here, say, my antiferromagnetic moment L, so L is S1 minus S2, then after I invert time, L changes to minus L. So L changes to minus L, B changes to minus B, so the right hand side does not change, and then the left hand side also does not change, and such effect is not forbidden by time inversion symmetry. A question from Ivan Yorsh: does this material has domain structure? What is the size of the domains compared to wavelengths? So I know only part of the answer. So it does have domain structure, indeed. And there are two kinds of domains. So if I look from top on this material, there are domains. So this is X, this is Y. There are domains like this, where L points here. It's S1, S2. And also there are domains rotated by 45 degrees, which is like this, by 90 degrees, sorry. So L points like this. This is S1, this is S2. It's a little bit strange, again, because it's very strong anisotropy. Now, in order to pin one of the domains, you need to apply very, very small magnetic field. What we do is just 50 millitesla. So under the magnetic field of 50 millitesla, only one of the domains is chosen. And in experiment, what happens is that there is no second harmonic unless you apply this very tiny magnetic field. So what this tiny magnetic field of 50 millitesla does, it just aligns the domains along one of the directions. So it chooses either this red direction or this blue direction. So, okay, now let me move on. And so there is this magnetoelectric coupling, but of course, in order to describe it properly, you need to do something better, and you need to take into account the anisotropy. So the proper way to describe it would be something like this. P alpha is proportional to some tensor. I don't know, let's call it U alpha beta gamma, L beta, and B gamma. So this tensor then depends on the anisotropy. And I just tell you that it's not original in the sense that maybe it's original for this material, but in principle, it's very nice paper in by Dzelashinsky from 1955, when he discovered this effect first in antiferromagnetics. So it's known. It's just special for this material because it has strong resonances. So this is the symmetry of magnetoelectric coupling at zero frequency for this material. So this is the magnetoelectric tensor. And it's kind of strange again. So if you were just to introduce it by hand, you would have chosen something at least diagonal. So this tensor is not diagonal and it's not symmetric. So this constants U and V, I don't know their values. It's only symmetry analysis, but they are not the same. So it has this magnetoelectric coupling and it's strongly anisotropic. This is at least interesting. Now what you can do with this coupling tensor, it's very interesting to separate it into symmetric part and anti-symmetric part. So you can do it with every tensor. So with every linear relationship, you can say that alpha is alpha symmetric plus alpha anti-symmetric. So, and I'm mostly interested in the anti-symmetric part, and it is can be rewritten just like this. So it's exactly the same relationship. So the same two constants, U and V, but the anti-symmetric part is basically proportional to U minus V. And the anti-symmetric part can be equivalently written as a cross product of some vector and the magnetic field. Because, well, I don't know, you can say that alpha, alpha beta, that's not so good. Alpha ij is proportional to something like this. So every anti-symmetric tensor can be rewritten as is dual to some vector. So there are two terms, the symmetric and anti-symmetric. Now what people say, so I don't understand that really well, but at least what people say in this field. So they say that the symmetric part, they call it quadrupolar coupling. And the anti-symmetric part, they call it magnetotoroidal coupling. And this is related to susceptibility of individual molecules. So suppose you have a molecule and you want to write its polarization as function of magnetic field. So apparently there are two kinds of couplings. Of course, there is coupling which is just linear in magnetic field and isotropic. But in principle, there are two more couplings. And I'm interested in this coupling because this coupling is due to some vector. This is very interesting. So this material, what you can think, it has a built-in toroidal vector. And let me try to give some graphical representation. So what is this magnetotoroidal moment? So T is magnetotoroidal moment. And it behaves under rotation operations a bit like a vector. So you have a cross product of one vector, of a pseudo vector, and this thing is again a vector. So this is what a polar vector, this is an axia, this is also polar vector, this is axial vector. So a cross product of a polar vector and an axial vector is also a polar vector. Okay. So simple way to understand this toroidal moment is like this. Green arrows are your spins. And for, on average, I have an antiferromagnetic. So on average, there is no spin. Then there is some antiferromagnetic moment, but it's not so interesting. What is more interesting is a construction like this. It's a momentum of spin distribution. So it's sum of RG cross SG. And this is my RG. This is SG. The sign is correct. So I have some vector product of vector and spin. And if this is not zero, then I have some built-in toroidal magnetic moment, which is, well, special, and it's interesting. And I think that actually among the listeners, there are really specialists in this field in the context of metamaterials and dielectric resonators and everything. So this toroidal moment is in principle equivalent to what people write now, say, for dielectric nanoparticles. So I think Andrei Miroshnichenko was one of the first people who started to work on this with silicon nanodiscs, and also we have Dragomir in the audience, and they know much more about this. So this, but originally this concept has been introduced in plasma physics. And here I am talking about toroidal moment in condensed matter physics and in spin physics. And there it's, yeah.
May interrupt you, sorry.
Yeah.
But it looks like above you are speaking about magnetic toroidal moment, but here what you are writing is actually electric toroidal moment. So which of the two things are you speaking about?
In my system, I have a magnetic toroidal moment. So, and it is basically related to this thing.
Well, because looking at this picture, since we have a curl of magnetic currents, this would correspond to some electric polarization. So isn't it?
This is exactly what I was talking about, Maxim. Mm-hmm. So right. So you have a curl of spins, and because of curl of spins, if you apply magnetic field, you get electric polarization. So it's magnetoelectric effect. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm.
And why do they call this like magnetic toroidal moment and a quadrupole moment once they get this type of link?
So Maxim, I understand it well, at least on symmetry backgrounds. I don't have a very good graphic explanation for it. And I think it's a subject of very active development. So basically, when you write such kind of equation, sum of RG, vector product SG, it's very well defined for a molecule or for some localized distribution of spins. It's not so well defined for a crystal because it's a magnetic moment, and where do you select the center? How do you select the unit cell?
Well, so I believe this, mm-hmm, once your spin is compensated inside the unit cell, nothing depends on the choice of the origin.
Nothing depends on the choice of the origin, exactly. But something might depend on the choice of the unit cell. Mm-hmm. So it's not a big problem for the antiferromagnetic moment for this thing. There it's okay because it's just average of the spins into sub, difference of the spins into sublattices. But for this thing, it's more important. And it's not obvious at all how to do it in a general crystal. I think that there is no theory, at least no final theory, of magneto-toroidal susceptibility of materials. Maybe there is such theory for metamaterials, but for materials, it's a subject of active studies. It's not understood. So what I can do some symmetry analysis. And then I can try to link it to effect in the molecules, but it's not done. So,
okay. But still, just the very last question, sorry for interrupting you. So if we look at the formula in this red rectangle and substitute S, roughly speaking, as R cross J, yes, then we get some expression which you written below, yes?
Yes.
And yes. You say that this is magnetic toroidal moment.
Yes. This is okay. Magnetic toroidal moment.
Okay.
Yeah,
we'll discuss later.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, even not I say, these people say, say magnetoelectric people, but well, I tried to repeat the calculations.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So now basically it's all almost over because due to this magneto electric coupling and toroidal moment, you have some vector or some polarization built in the system. And it is this polarization that activates second harmonic. So the effect looks like this. You have a toroidal moment, and my main equation is maybe this one. So electric field at second harmonic frequency is proportional to toroidal moment stationary in this system, and also Ez omega squared. So this is the symmetry of the effect. And it's kind of interesting because it's very similar to static magnetoelectric effect, because this guy, it just provides some energy. It does not affect the symmetry. So it's like static magnetoelectric effect, but then you add just two photons. So your second harmonic is proportional to your toroidal moment. And this explains, say, the selection rules. So this Ez omega is along the crystallographic axis. It does not matter much for symmetry analysis. And everything depends on this toroidal moment. And there is one more contribution, which is induced by the magnetic field. Without any toroidal moment, without any spins, you have a contribution like this. So Ex to omega is proportional to Bx times Ez omega squared. Now you have these two contributions. So one is induced by magnetic field and non-centrosymmetric crystal structure. Another is toroidal. And now you have to add them. And they can interfere. And if they interfere, you get different second harmonic depending if you add them or if you subtract them. So the difference between second harmonic for positive and negative magnetic field will be proportional to your magnetic field and to your toroidal moment. So in principle, it's a very, very simple effect. It's an interference of your spin order and of your magnetic field. So it's toroidal, it's magnetic, and they interfere. And the effect is very strong because it's at the resonances. So I still have one experimental picture to show, but if you have pictures to the questions to the toroidal part, maybe it's already time to ask them because I'm basically over. And so before, so what everything I was talking about was about toroidal second harmonic and magnetic second harmonic. And crystallographic second harmonic was zero because my incident field was along the crystallographic axis Z. So it's Ez omega and then crystallographic contribution, which is of this type is zero, just as for gallium arsenide. Now what I can do, I can slightly tilt the sample. And if I tilt the sample, I get one more contribution because of the crystallographic harmonic. And basically this is what they see.
Excuse me, before you go to the tilting, so could you please compare those explanations regarding the efficiency of harmonic generation with respect to magnetic field and toroidal moment? Could you please discuss it again in terms of the experimental results you have shown in the very beginning?
So I don't have numbers. Only thing I can say is like this. So you have these domains in experiment. And these domains have some spin orientation. So you have some particular domain, you have some spin order, you have some antiferromagnetic moment, and you have some toroidal moment. Then you have second harmonic because of this toroidal moment. And there is one more because of magnetic field. So if you change the sign of magnetic field, these two contributions interfere either constructively or destructively. And that's why the second harmonic intensity changes. That's all I can say. So ideally, of course, it would be very nice to consider microscopically the electronic structure of this material and to derive some susceptibility nonlinear for second harmonic. But it's, well, not yet done just. It's been some picture. We have some picture from Maxim. Yeah. So I might be even, I don't know how to show it, but yeah, it's indeed basically about the toroidal dipole moment. Yeah. I can only write this equation from Maxim on the slide just in case. So it has T, which is proportional to integral to R Rp minus P R squared dV. Yeah, it's toroidal dipole moment. Toroidal dipole moment. I have toroidal magnetic moment. I think these two are very closely related. So it's only a question if I have some stationary distribution of current, or I have some polarization.
Yes, Sasha, but sorry for interrupting you. You told previously that your toroidal moment at least behaves as a polar vector, yes? And this is important.
It's not yes. Axial.
Yes, and I believe that electric toroidal moments, they transform as polar vectors, similarly to the usual dipole moment, whereas magnetic toroidal moment, it also exists, but it transforms similarly to a magnetic dipole moment. So as an axial vector.
Maxim, so...
So I insist that this is like electric toroidal moment.
I have to think a little
maybe,
bit.
Maybe I'm wrong.
So there are two parts I can say. So one is, I think spin is an axial vector, right?
Yes, absolutely.
And R is a polar vector.
Absolutely.
So their product, at least to me, looks like the vector product looks like a polar vector.
Totally agree, yes. This is polar vector.
So my magnetic toroidal moment looks like a polar vector, this thing in this one looks like a polar vector.
Yeah, so your quantity is a polar vector. And therefore, what I'm saying is that this should be electric toroidal moment, but need to think and compare different
definitions. Maybe it's... I think people in different communities might call it by different names. And okay. I'm not sure I'm fully aware because people are studying it for magnetoelectrics and they have toroidal moment. Then it's a question how they call them.
Yeah, I will look in the literature how they define this magnetic toroidal moment. I do know that they calculated it. And this is expression with the cross. So L cross J times some factor.
Okay, so, but anyway, thank you very much because I'm very new to this field. Only such, how to say, in real crystal, the symmetry is very low, so you don't really have polar vector or axial vector. The symmetry is much lower, and this naive analysis does not apply anyway, unfortunately, because it has some non-symmorphic crystal structure and whatever, so the symmetry is a little bit weird. So even, unfortunately, all these concepts from molecules and or meta-atoms, even if I knew them, they are not directly applicable for this crystal structure because the symmetry is low. But anyway, so last picture, sorry for switching off everything. So last picture is about slightly tilted sample. So what they can do is they can tilt the sample either to the left or to the right. And when they do this, they activate crystallographic second harmonic because crystallographic second harmonic has this symmetry. So it's easy omega, but also if you tilt the sample, you get EY omega, which is proportional to tilting. So it's E to omega X. So because of the tilting, you get non-zero component of EY omega, and then you have three sources of second harmonic. So now you have toroidal, you have magnetic, and you have crystallographic. And you can control them, and you can induce this very nice asymmetric shapes. So the broad background is because of the crystallographic second harmonic, which is white, it's spectrally broad. And spectrally narrow contributions are because of the magnetic second harmonic, and they interfere. So I would not call it fun resonance because I think it's just plain interference, but well, it still very much reminds fun resonance and it is controllable. So left is one tilting, right is another tilting, and for each tilting you have some non-reciprocity. So everything, the second harmonic can be controlled either by changing magnetic field or by changing the tilting angle. So, and it's, I think I have somewhere nice expression which tells you the symmetry of the effect. So this thing is toroidal. This thing is magnetic. And this thing is crystallographic. And they all interfere in second harmonic. So apparently this material has very, very nice resonances. And these resonances sense spin distributions. And also apparently people can talk about Fano resonances or Fano-like resonances and toroidal moments, in not only in contexts and resonances and spatial dispersion and magnetoelectric coupling. So this all can happen not only in metamaterials, but also in metaborate. And that's it. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Sasha, very much. So colleagues, do we have more questions on the topic? Maxim?
Yeah, thank you so much. I will ask the remaining questions which I skipped. So the first question is the following. So we got very complicated expression for electric polarization, which depends on.
And even here we have a lot of constants, and it's a separate work to fit all these constants, so they are not known. And also, indeed, as you say, there are effects which magnetic polarization is proportional to electric field. Also, we see some signatures in experiment that there is some residual ferromagnetic moment. And this means that there are like 8 more constants allowed by symmetry. So only one thing that I can say, that all effects you can imagine, like spatial dispersion, non-linearity, magnetoelectric coupling, some magneto-chiral type of effects, they are all present in this material, and almost nothing is known about them, even in linear optics. Mm-hmm.
By the
so
way,
it seems it's huge to be done.
I believe very, very nice concept is that you can have this nonlinear polarization proportional to the product of E and B, because a couple of years ago, there was a work from metamaterials community where people demonstrated these electromagnetic nonlinearities. So I guess that from this symmetry analysis follows that there could be similar magneto-electric response for these metaborates.
Yes, so as you say, it's like P to omega is proportional to E omega and then B omega. Well, I can call it instead of B omega, I can write it like E omega and here electric, how to say,
wave vector,
which is like nonlinear spatial dispersion. So this is what also can happen. So they see a lot of effects in experiment which we don't understand at all. So for instance, here are magnons in the magnetic lattice. And apparently magnons can also control emissions. So you, I don't really know the details, but due to magnons, you can also enable some one-way emission or some non-reciprocity or everything. So it's a very, very special material because resonances are narrow and symmetry is low and magnetoelectric coupling is strong.
And then I had a question more about like experimental part. So you demonstrated that changing magnetic field, you can easily tune the spectral properties of second harmonic signal. Then the question, how fast is this process? Let's say you are switching
Femtosecond,
your magnetic field.
Well, I don't know, but it's measured second harmonic. I don't know very well, but apparently the scale is femtosecond. So here second harmonic is measured by femtosecond pulses. So it's a relatively complicated technique. And also, I think that this work I did before, so it's wrong, maybe not, but it's work from our Japanese competitors. So they call it femtosecond activation of magnetoelectricity. So it's very fast. Then you can use all the buzzwords like terahertz. Terahertz is picosecond, right? So it's even better.
Yeah, this is very promising. So this means that you are switching magnetic field and at the scale of femtoseconds, you can get this.
Yeah, but it's everything at 5K. So just to stay realistic, it's all at very, very low temperatures. So
maybe. Yeah, for sure. Because there are no, you know, panacea. Okay, thanks. Thanks.
Sasha, I want to bring your attention that we also have a question from Australia. So Dragomir is asked, what are the linear properties such as transparency and refractive index of the material?
So it has, I had somewhere absorption spectrum. I think I had it. So it's absorption coefficient. So the crystal is blue because of this blue transparency gap. There are basically what I'm talking about are resonant lines here. So I don't remember refractive index of drug. This is so I don't remember, but it's a dielectric. I don't think that it has very large refractive index. And there are these resonances which are controllable by magnetic field. So I don't remember about refractive index, but this is absorption spectrum.
Okay, Sasha, may I ask you maybe a silly question? So can we somehow affect the toroidal moment?
I think so. So I don't, well, understand it. I can only repeat what Isarev says, who has been working on this material for 30 years already, that if you apply magnetic fields, say perpendicular to the spins, they first want to be along this 45 degree axis, but then they will eventually align along the magnetic field. So if you apply magnetic field, you can rotate the spins basically. And if you rotate the spins, probably you can rotate the toroidal moment. In principle, in terms of symmetry analysis, the effect I'm talking about could be interpreted as rotation of toroidal moment because in some sense, because at least I'm controlling toroidal moment in some sense by magnetic field. I could say it, but Maybe. I'm not so sure. So it's a lot to be understood.
In this case, if you so that formula where you've been writing that, so those changes are proportional to the both magnetic field and toroidal moment, this means that this dependence is a bit more tricky as a function of magnetic field ice. So the formula at the right.
Well, here I'm only writing contributions to second harmonic, linear in magnetic field and in spin, so in toroidal moment, whatever. Now, if I take this thing squared, I will get terms bx squared, ly squared, bx ly. So I am talking about this term, it's the same as bx tx, it's the same term. But of course, I think that if you apply, if you apply magnetic field in some other direction, you will also affect this Ly. So my expression assumes that these two contributions are independent. In fact, they are not. So what has been also measured, somewhere I have here the phase diagram. I think this is the phase diagram of this material as function of orientation of magnetic field and crystallographic and temperature. So this is my phase diagram. So before I was talking about this phase commensurate C. It's the phase with toroidal moment. But there are many other phases. So I even don't remember what is the phase P. But IC is the incommensurate phase where all spins point basically in different directions. And there is neither toroidal moment nor anti-ferromagnetic moment. Now, what has been measured, the sensitivity of second harmonic to magnetic field has been measured rather accurately and in different geometries. And it's very, very sensitive. And indeed, in experiment, there is much more sensitivity than what is explained by my naive formula. So theory is lagging for this material very far beyond experiment. So its theory is 10 behind experiment. Theory is 10 years behind experiment, I would say. We don't know much. But it's all very, very, very sensitive. So as you can see, it's second harmonic at different peaks as function of magnetic field, and everything depends on everything, on frequency, on orientation of magnetic field, on temperature. It's very, very sensitive material, and I'm surprised. So no one was really interested in it before, aside from Isarev in Dortmund and these people in Japan. But maybe in some moment it will gain popularity.
Thank you, Sasha. Colleagues, any more questions? So if not, I will first try to allow you switching on your microphones without switching them by myself. Hopefully it works like this. So probably you may switch on your microphone to thank Sasha. But before that, I would like to announce our next seminar, if you allow me. So it will be, as Sasha mentioned before, it will be given by Professor Alexei Kimmel from Radboud University of Nijmegen in the Netherlands. He will be talking about terahertz emission from emerging ferromagnetism in ferromradite. So the seminar will be held at its usual time at 10 a.m. St. Petersburg time next Friday, May 15. So so Dima knows how to make the applause. Anyway, if you allow, so if you can switch on your microphones, let us thank Sasha. I'm not sure it works. Sasha,
thank
anyway,
you very much.
I'll make the applause. Okay, thanks to everyone.
Thank you.